Oh, we're live. Thanks, Jeff. Hello, and welcome to a Denis-less edition of The Scoop. Denis is on holidays, currently in Gdansk with his lad friend, shouting lads, 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 and having banter. I'm sure he's having a great time. We have myself, James, who's usually behind the camera on the show today, and Jeff is now replacing me behind the camera, so that's why we're having some hiccups and or technical difficulties. I gotta stop doing this. With me today is Alex Ball, notable finalist of GP Sydney, which we'll talk about a little bit later, and he just came back from GP Madrid,
yeah,
where he did horribly in the team
absolutely
event.
Absolutely, yeah. It was awful.
Sad boys.
Yeah.
So first up on the show today, we're just gonna talk about the lovely playmat that you'll get if you sign up for the VIP package at GP Seattle. It is fantastic Mark Pool art of Urza's Tower. What do you think, Alex?
Yeah, I like it a lot. I like that it's quite minimalist. So you just have the two colours, green in the bottom, the clouds and the sky in the sky.
The sky clouds in the sky. Oh, who knew?
But it's very different to what playmats normally are for GPs. I think it's a good choice. And it's also expected to be divisive between those who like Tron and the people.
We gotta stop doing this. This is not a thing.
The normal people.
Yeah, rabbit hands. So only Tron players like this, you think? Or is this just I like classic magic art, this is
yeah, like
cool.
the Brian Whelans of the world will lose their minds over this.
Brian Whelan, notable Tron player.
People
don't know who Brian Whelan is unless they've watched the show. The two times he's been on.
I'd say he'd be up in arms. Well, not up in arms. He'll be raising his arms about this. But like, I don't play Tron, and I still think it's a really, really nice art. I can appreciate it.
You want to represent Tron in such a positive manner? It's almost saying Tron, it's okay.
Yeah, like if I'm playing another deck on this playmat, like what I'm suggesting. Yeah, you're probably right.
You're just giving off implications that it's okay to play Tron. Is it okay to play Tron?
Depends on who you are. Depends on your personality, whether you're good or a bad person. Is Brian a good person?
No.
No.
Am I a good person? And I don't even play Tron. You don't have to answer that. That's okay. I'm sure chat will do it for you. Okay. So let's talk about GP Madrid.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I'm sure people have very much already seen the playmat and love it and will be signing up for a VIP package at cfvevents.com right now. Shameless. So, tell me about GP Madrid. How did it go for you?
So, not great. I played with two of my good friends, Steven Robertson and Guido Sondag. And I'll be teaming again with Guido in Amsterdam in a few weeks. So, I played Modern, I played Jund, Guido played Blue-Black Midrange, and Steve played Four Color Pile with Controversial Punishing Fire. And
Why is that controversial, exactly?
It's not a normal edition.
No, that's check pile.
It's check pile with
plus punishing fire.
Yeah. So taking out three good lands, like you're making your mana significantly worse and removing strong cards, like you remove like a Colligan's Command.
So just for the non-legacy players.
Yeah.
How does check pile work?
Check pile is four colors, every color but white, and just plays the best colors of those four colors. So it plays Leovold, the Sultai 3-3 from Conspiracy.
Yep.
Plays Colligan's Command, plays Bolt. Apparently it plays Punishing Fire.
But only in Steve's version. And how did that go for Steve with his special legacy tech for the GP?
Yeah, like better than expected, given it was his first time playing it. So he went a solid 0-5.
What was expected?
In Legacy. In fairness to him, he went 0-4 with one unfinished. But That game was going one way, so...
Not his way?
Not his way. Okay. He'll say it was his way, but no, it was
What's
not going
your
his
own
way.
Record? You played Modern.
I played Modern. I played Jund. So I was 5-0 with Jund. I think Jund's in a great spot right now. So our overall team record was Guido's record, which is 2-3.
Is that great spot your hands?
Sorry?
Jund's great spot, is that...
It's in my hands.
Your hands.
Yeah, absolutely. No, like Jund, like with the unbanning of Blood Red Elf, I think Jund is in a good spot. It's not the best deck, but I think it's definitely tier one again. And it has just a good place in the format. But we can talk a bit about that later.
Yeah. If it's not the best deck in Modern right now, what is?
What is the best deck? I think it's hard to quantify the best deck. There's maybe five decks at the moment that you wouldn't be embarrassed to play. Like they're all just going to be great. Tron is still great. Jund. The odd one, Boggles, has done really well. Or Bogles. Depending on how you pronounce
it. That's very controversial. We shouldn't bring that name up. It's Beaujolais.
Beaujolais,
of course.
Yeah. But that's done really well often kind of off the resurgence of Jund. That's kind of why Boggles has started seeing play. Like, I won a GP and I won the Mox just 2 weekends ago. Burn has gotten better as well. So any of those lists, like realistically, Modern's very open. There's probably 10 decks you could play and be happy with. I wouldn't be able to pick just one exact deck that's the best deck at the moment.
And for Standard, what did Guido play?
So he played blue-black mid-range as opposed to control. So that was with the addition of, so yeah, Scarab God, Gear Hulks, but also Gonti, Glintsleaf Siphoner, those cards. The Aetherborn, the black 2/3 lifelink death touch.
Gifted Aetherborn?
Gifted Aetherborn. He played that as well. And then a lot of similar cards to the control list, so Fatal Push, etc. So he won. He went 2/3, losing the mirror, losing against the Godfarer's gift deck.
That almost came out very wrong.
Godfarer's gift deck. That's a tough matchup. And I forget the other deck he lost against.
That's all right. Don't worry. So Guido's list was the blue-black mid-range deck, but one of the actual winning decks was blue-black control. Yeah. So we've got Elias Watzfeldt's blue-black control list up in front of us here. So we can have a look through it. So can you tell me, like, is this top of the meta now? Is this the deck to beat?
I think blue-black control and blue-black mid-range kind of collectively, because they are very similar. It just depends kind of which trajectory you want to go in, but they run a lot of the similar cards. Either one of those, that's the best deck, I think. And the power of Scarab God, and so this, does this have, where's Scarab God? Yeah, there he is. Yeah. So the power of Scarab God, like Scarab God is probably the strongest card in the format. So maximizing his strength, which is what the mid-range deck likes to do. It runs the Dusk Legion Zealot, the 2-mana 1/1 that draws a card when enters, runs Gonti. So maximizing cards that are great to rebuy with Scarab God. And it's just able to fight off against most decks of the format. So it's good against the aggro decks in Mono Red and the Black and Mardu. Cause it has Moment of Craving for life, it has Vrass's Contempt, it has Fatal Push. It just has a lot of early answers. And then Scarab God wins a game fast. Like, the way you beat those kind of aggro decks is stabilizing, but then turning around quickly enough that you don't give them an opportunity to finish you off. Like, in Modern, like, playing like Jund against Burn, the best way to win is having an early Tarmogoyf, because then you can have early pressure and you don't give them too many turns. So it's the same in this. So this is good against those aggro decks with its early removal, and then using Scarab God to turn that corner. And against any of the mid-range decks, Scarab God just dominates. So I think this is definitely the best deck, but I don't think that's a reason that this is the only deck. Like, I don't think it's a one-deck format. Okay. There are definitely other decks that you can play.
What would prey on this? What's this weak against?
It's hard to say. Like, the Godfarer's Gift deck, when we were at the GP, Godfarer's Gift was quite strong, and Guido had a hard time. He had to kind of hold up and negate in awkward spots in Essence Gatherer to try to combat the gift coming down. This doesn't have a real way to answer artifacts once they're actually down. So if Godfarer's Gift gets the gift out and starts reanimating, that's difficult. Scarab God can kind of fight on that access, reanimating their powerful threats. Yeah. But it is quite difficult, I think.
So. Okay, so it's not just top of the format, no competition whatsoever.
Exactly, yeah. Like, okay. I do think it's the best deck, but there are ways to fight it.
And
for sure.
Why mid-range over this at the GP?
Why Guido played mid-range?
Yeah.
Again, we wanted to maximize the strength of Scarab God. So we didn't play the Dusk Legion Zealot, although I think that was probably a mistake. I think that card's really important to that deck. But we just wanted to maximize the power of Scarab God against all of the other decks. Like, Scarab God can win against anything. So maximizing there, like, we ran no disallows and just had a couple of Essence Scatterers main deck instead.
Okay.
So that was kind of our strategy, but I wouldn't be able to pick if I was to play mid-range or control. It's kind of, they're very similar. At a push, I'd probably play the mid-range deck. A few popular Twitch streamers have been playing it online. They've been doing really well with it, so.
Is that preference or because you think it's more competitive?
For me, it's probably preference.
Okay.
But yeah, I'd say slightly more competitive. At the moment, I'd say the mid-range deck is probably the right choice, but I'm not faulting anyone for picking either or.
And just before we move on from this onto the modern list that won the GP, it's a team event, so decks, of course. Why Metallurgic Summonings in the sideboard? I haven't seen that card in a while. Yeah. Since the Summonings deck that briefly had a bit of popularity on Modo.
It looks a bit spicy, but it's actually really good. So it's really good in, if you can resolve it against the control lists, Now you just have, again, as I said, like they have a very hard time fighting off enchantments and artifacts. So you have commit to try to bounce it, but once it's down, suddenly every spell you cast is getting a free body. You end up in a counterfight, you have to disallow something, you get a 3-3. You want to commit something, you get a 4-4. Fastest Contempt on their Scarab God, 4-4. So if you manage to resolve this, it's just a huge threat that can kind of snowball your advantage over the course of the game. So it's really good in those matchups.
Okay, let's have a look at the modern list that won the GP. This is Grixis Shadow, piloted by Ben Jones. So this is a pretty standard Grixis list, right? Is there anything standing out to you here that seemed out of place or seems a bit different to the usual lists?
No, not really. Like two teamer Battle Rage, and that's somewhat unusual. A lot of lists run none, some run just the one copy, so two gives it a little bit of extra punch. And in the sideboard, yeah, the Rejections are mainstay, Brutality's mainstay, Explosives are kind of trying to fight against Bogles and Lantern and things like that. But yeah, there's nothing outrageous.
Just very stock, very standard. Why does this deck not play four Lightning Bolts?
Why does it not play four Lightning Bolts? It's hard to fit in. So you have kind of certain requirements that you need.
Does damage, and you want to do damage to yourself. You could bolt yourself. Does one more point of damage than bosses.
You could, but there's little reason for that when your lands are doing it for free.
Okay.
Your Street Threat's doing it for free. Like Bolt, ultimately, you have to give up a card for that. And it doesn't need, like, it can get down very easily to 6, 7, 8 without having to waste a card on it. So like the Fetchlands, Thoughtseize, and Street Wraith. That's all you need to get down to a life total. And it has things that you just need. So you need your 4 Death Shadow, Snapcaster Mage and Colicate's Command, you need your Street Wraith, you need 4 Thoughtseize, and you need Thoughtscarer to turn on your Delve Creatures and Anglers and Tassigar. You need Fatal Push for the Mirror, for Burn, for Affinity, things like that, for Jund against Goyf. And just has no other way to really kill a Goyf.
Has push effectively pushed out Bolt in that case?
So for a while, yes. So for a while, push became what it was, the best removal spell in the format. And it just killed Death Shadow, it killed Tarmogoyf, it killed Young Pyromancer, just killed all of the big threats that you needed to kill. And which is partly why Grixis Shadow became quite good, because it was able to run Anglers and Tassigar that, like, nothing in the format really killed. You have Path to Exile, but not too many decks play that. It's many of the blue-white control decks. And you had things like Terminate, but even not many people were running that either. So, though this became, Angler and Tasker became premium threats in the format, while pushed out smaller ones. But that's kind of turned around in a little bit now with Bloodbraid Elf. So in Jund, you really want to play 4 Lightning Bolt instead of 4 push, because in the worst case scenario, if you have a Bloodbraid Elf,
you don't want to cascade into push with no target.
Exactly, yeah. Ultimately, like, Lightning Bolt's still not a great hit, but you can still just target your opponent and get something out of it. Whereas push on an empty board is just, you're just playing a 4-mana 3-2 haste.
So. Did you play against this at the GP?
I did not play against Shadow.
Why do you think Shadow made it to the final and won?
So it's hard to say in a team event. Like, it's hard to...
Oh, sure, this guy could have lost all his matches and they still won.
Yeah, yeah. Like, but, there's that famous case of Jacob Wilson where he went, like, 1-13 in a team event but won the GP because his teammates did so well. So I don't know what these individual records were.
But do you think this deck is well-positioned right now in the format?
Yeah, yeah. Again, I don't think anything is the best deck, but if I were to give you the 5 decks that you should consider playing at a GP, Grixis Shadow is going to be among them. It's very, very similar to Jund. It just has a very robust strategy. It can fight against everybody with discard spells, a fast clock with Death Shadow. It always has a fight. So.
All right, let's have a look at the Legacy winning deck, which is Eldrazi Stompy.
Yeah.
And to me, this looks like a fair deck in Legacy. Yeah. That's probably not quite right. Like, but
it's fair to a degree, but if you look at the mana base is where the...
That's not fair.
Yeah.
Not even close.
That's not fair at all. So it's 4 Ancient Tomb, 4 Eldrazi Temple, and then there should be City of Traders and Eye of Ugin. Yeah, yeah, there's two.
All in there.
Yeah. The mana base is what's unfair about this. So it's just playing majority creatures that were printed in the last couple of years that in Standard didn't really make too much of an impact. But
that destroyed Modern briefly.
Destroyed Modern.
Including the Pro Tour you played on.
Yeah, yeah. I did not expect Eldrazi to do well that Pro Tour.
I got suitably
destroyed. I played Burn, and yeah, I played against Ivan Falk, who was playing the Eldrazi list then, and it was not close.
He'd beat you anyway, though.
Yeah, he'd beat me anyways. I'm not saying I could beat him on a normal day, but he, like, absolutely destroyed me.
So what are the key cards in Eldrazi Stompy? What makes this deck tick, besides the lands?
So, yeah, like the lands are definitely the most important part. So Chalice of the Void is something you can play off things like City of the Traders and Ancient Tomb. So you can play for kind of cheating on its mana cost, so above its mana cost for the turn that you're on. So being able to play that early is able to lock out certain decks against combo, or just helps catch you up. Like against the Delver decks, you can put it on one, and now that's hitting Delver, Bolt, Brainstorm, Ponder, etc. So that's definitely a key card. But your main cards other than that are Thought Knot Seer and Reality Smasher. So Thought Knot Seer giving you this Thoughtseize-esque effect, often coming down on turn two, just allows you to kind of plan your game around what the opponent has, and interrupt combo decks, of which there are a lot in Legacy.
Yeah, for sure.
And it's also hard to kill. Like it's a 4/4, and there's not too many ways. Like a lot of the removal in Legacy, it's kind of similar to Modern. People aren't playing just straight up kill this creature. So you have Bolt, you do have Fatal Push, and you have Dismember. But sometimes it's hard to deal with the 4 toughness as well.
And Reality Smash, of course, is exceptionally hard to remove
because of its
extra ability. Yeah. Let's have a look at the sideboard. Mm-hmm. So the thing that stood out to me most is the Sorcerer's Spyglass. Is this just a better pithing needle in a deck that produces 2 colorless with all its lands?
Interesting. Yeah, like I haven't actually thought about that before. Like I haven't seen Sorcerer's Spyglass outside of Standard, but yeah, that could be
you get to look at their hand as well as having the pithing needle effect. That's very powerful when you're just tapping for 2.
Yeah, with the right. When your lands are tapping for 2 anyways. Now you can't do it off Eldrazi Temple, or the Eye of Ugin, but you still have the 4 Ancient Tombs and the 2 City of Traders. So absolutely, yeah, I can definitely see that. I was just going to say again, it goes to Thought Knot Seer. I've been able to see their hand is allowed to craft that game plan around it.
And then you have 4 Leyline of the Void. That is a lot of hedging against the likes of Storm and Reanimator.
Yeah, so this deck otherwise has no way to fight against these decks, and those types of combo decks are so fast that, like, ultimately, you're right. Like, you are playing somewhat of a fair game. You're trying to play creatures ahead of the curve and turn them sideways. But this deck isn't winning on turn 2 or turn 3. So Leyline of the Void is kind of a necessity against those kind of decks to give you a fighting chance. Now you get to play your Leyline of the Void, and even though you're not actually killing your opponent until turn 4, turn 5.
They're taking a lot longer and hoping to remove it, but otherwise maybe not getting the game plan off.
You need something, and since it's colorless, since it's a colorless deck, there aren't too many options.
Yeah.
So like this being just a free spell at the start of the game is, necessity.
Another one that stood out to me a bit is All Is Dust. That's a lot of mana in Legacy. I know this deck makes a lot of mana, but that seems exceptionally high.
So it is high, but again, I think it does come down to the mana again. So Eye of Ugin will make this cheaper as well, because it's tribal Eldrazi. So you have 4, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, you have 13 lands that tap for 2 mana. And when you're making 7, 8 mana by turn 4, it's not too much difficulty. Like in matchups against 4-color pile, for example. And they can build up a lot of random permanents, Baleful Strixes, Snapcasters, Jace, and being able to have this and just wipe the board while you keep yours. Yeah, I quite like that in those kind of matchups.
Do you think this deck is good right now in Legacy? I know you're not a big Legacy player, but do you think playing a fair game like this is a good game plan in Legacy?
Yeah, I'd say so. Like Legacy's not my forte, but It's not a format besides Grixis Delver at the moment that's getting a lot of controversy given how prevalent it is. Talking to everyone at the GP, they were saying they played against Grixis Delver almost every round. Like a lot of people talking about a Deathrite Shaman ban because of it. But even given the prevalence of Grixis Delver, absolutely, like this is a deck that it's fair. But what I like about all 3 of these decks is that they can win any game. Like you're never just a complete dog to a particular matchup. Like Grixis Shadow always has a chance with its discard spells and its early clock. Blue Black Midrange with Scarab God is just generically powerful. And the same with this, you just get to play your threats, and you're never going into a matchup saying I'm just gonna lose.
Because you can just disrupt whatever they do in some way with Chalice and with your sideboard.
You've big boys come down early and they can win games.
So you're saying who wins a format full of crazy combos and unfair things, or some smashy boys.
Some smashy boys.
So smashy boys win.
Well, clearly they won the GP, so right. I think that's just fact.
Well, well done to the winners of GP Madrid.
Yeah,
we're going to move on to talk about a bit of Masters 25. We've got a pack one, pick one coming up for you. And everyone we know is probably down in our LGS right now drafting this format, so we're going to pretend we're drafting it here with this pack one, pick one. So we've got a pretty spicy pack. There's some good cards in here. I mean, one is standing out to me big time, but that's personal preference. I do love Wolves.
Yeah.
But I think there's a lot to look at in this pack, because I think it represents a lot of what the set does. And we'll just start with Unearth here. So there's two reanimation spells, as far as I remember, in the format. This and Zombify. And they're both very powerful effects. Particularly Unearth is for one black mana, you can bring back a threat.
And it seems
straight onto the battlefield. It seems to be three.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which...
Well, in this format, there's a lot of cheap threats you can bring back. So it's not bringing back Nicol Bolas or anything like that.
But it's still... Absolutely. You know, it's bringing back something. Maybe you can lose a mana dork and bring it back. Mm-hmm. You can bring back your Horseshoe Crab and put that Presence of Gond in it and combo off with your Splinter Twin.
It's also like we're not picking it here, but it has cycling as well. So even if your graveyard is empty of targets, you can just cycle it away.
Cycling on a card is just always so good. Strong. Yeah. Okay, next up we've got Savannah Lines, which is a pretty powerful former rare. For a one drop.
It was a rare,
yeah.
Man.
Now it's a common 2/1 Savannah Lions.
Yeah, time's not been kind for this cat.
Well, it's still a very good card. You can draft White Weenie. You can draft this and a few Squadron Hawks and smash someone pretty quick.
Like, okay, yeah, it's a 1-mana 2/1, but that's not broken. That's not in Limited, that's nothing special. Mm. Like, if you play this on turn 1, you get to attack on turn 2 for 2, but there's very little difference between, in Limited anyways, there's very little difference between a 1-mana 2/1 and a 2-mana 2/1.
Sure.
You know? Like, unless you have to have the scenario where you had a 2-drop as well, but if you don't have a 2-drop, it doesn't matter when this comes down, you're throwing away 2 damage. Like, it's not enough of a difference to make this a powerful card when a 2-mana 2/1 is a poor card.
Just doing the same thing.
It's just an error. Yeah.
Alright, well, what about a 2-mana 2/1 in Soulbright Flamekin.
As the elemental that makes mana, isn't it?
It gives target creature trample, and you can add a bunch of mana to your mana pool if you've done it 3 times.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting effect. I'm not sure I want to pick it because of that, but it's a late-game mana sink that makes more mana to sink.
You can give 3 of your things... If you have 6 mana, you can give 3 of your things trample, and you get, is it 8 mana back?
You
have to count up the things.
1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah, it's 8.
Yeah, so you can make an additional 2 mana if you want, if you have at least 6. The element, it's an elemental as well, so not really important in this set, but it was in...
Yeah, it's not a tribal set anymore, but it was important when it was... It was
in Modern Masters 2, where there were a lot of elementals.
And
so
Lorwyn.
Second returning master card for
we're not taking the Soulbright Flamekin.
No.
So far it's unearthed for me, but... Balduvian Horde is pretty aggressive. Now, it's got a drawback, but it's a 4-mana 5/5, which is nothing to turn your nose up at.
Yeah, absolutely. You can discard...
Random is risky business.
Yeah, like, the ideal scenario for this is you play it with an empty hand.
It's a curve topper for an aggro deck.
Exactly.
For me. Yeah.
So you play it, you go, like, guy, play it on turn maybe 5 or 6, be able to play this and a 2-drop at the same time, and then have nothing to discard. And now you've just played well above the curve, just playing a 4-mana 5/5.
But are you taking it?
No. So far, none of these, like, I probably agree, I'm probably taking Unearth.
Might take the Balduvian Horde here, just out of those 4, just because I think I could go into a pretty strong aggro deck and have a very powerful curve topper.
Like, to be honest, I'm not mad on any of these 4. I'm looking forward to when we get to the uncommons.
Well, let's talk about the Griffin Protector, who is... He's pretty good. The +1/+1, there are some token generators. You've got Hordling Outburst, I guess, but I mean, it's in a different color, but you do have some ways to generate tokens. If this goes in a Horseshoe Crab Presence of Gond deck, I don't see how you ever lose.
You're in, yeah.
You're just in then. And, you know, I'm still not taking it, but Retraction Helix, if you want that combo deck, you know... You're just going off.
Yeah.
You're just bouncing everybody.
Well, like, are there any comments? You can do it.
This is a lot of wishful thinking on my part here.
I think so.
I don't think these two cards in a vacuum, pack one, pick one, I'm not really excited.
No,
about.
They
do some cool things in the format as a whole.
Yeah, no, this is kind of middle of the pack pick or pack 3. If you do have things like Hordling Outburst and things, then this goes up in value. But here, no.
Haunted Fengraph is...
What does that even do?
It, you can pay three and sacrifice it to return a creature card at random from your graveyard.
A lot of that random effects.
I like this in an EDH deck, I guess.
Yeah, no,
but
it's
not. It's not a.
It's not an effect. One. Yeah, it's not an effect I'm looking at.
No,
here I don't like taking a land pick. Pack one either.
Massively so. Prefer the Dauntless Cathar. I think that's an excellent card.
This is the best. This is the best card so far in the pack. So it was amazing.
Not the wolf token?
Not the wolf token, oh, no, I'm sorry voice. To say.
I like that wolf
I'm taking that out of the pack and just putting it aside.
Just keeping it for your own personal wolf token
personal
collection.
Personal collection, yeah. Thousands.
Dauntless Cathar, to me, is great. It's
really good.
It's great on turn three, and it can trade with something bigger, and it brings you back a 1-1 flyer, which can just either block something else if you need to, or just beat down.
Yeah, it was great in Shadows of Umbrastadt. Really, really good, and it's going to be great here. I think just the fact that you can trade it off, and then buy back a spirit token later, that has a lot of value. So it's just a 2-for-1.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, definitely the best card so far. For I'm sure. Taking that.
So another token generating card. Mm-hmm. Another 3 powers. 3/3 Ambassador Oak. 4 mana for a 3/3 and a 1/1.
And great art. Yeah, he's munching, is he? Munching on those birds.
He's bringing along his elf for the ride so they can munch birds together, I guess.
So it's similar to the Cathar. So it's a 4 mana 3/3, but brings along a 1/1. I'd rather the spirit.
Me too.
I think.
But this one gives you both at the same time, which has its own value, and it is 3 toughness. That's relevant against
the
format. There's lots of 2/1s. Savannah Lines, Soul Bright Flame. I mean, I think it's still the Cathar so far.
I think so.
Just edges it.
The Cathar is... I just want to check. Yeah, the Cathar is also 3 mana.
Yeah.
And you can divide it up between the 3 mana and the 2 to exile versus the 4 here. So I think I like the Cathar more still.
Okay, so next we've got Elvish Aberration. The 4/5 for 6 that adds 3 green mana to your mana pool. Now for me, by the time I'm paying 6 mana, I don't know if I care about...
No,
you know,
you don't.
A creature that makes more mana. But very relevant for cycling for 2.
Yeah, for cycling's great.
It's reasonable late and reasonable early. It's not an amazing card, but it's... It's got value at different stages of the game, which is important.
Yeah, like you're right that when you're paying 6 mana for a card like this, the tapping for 3, that's not broken. That's not incredibly exciting. But there are turns where you untap and suddenly you have access to 10 mana.
Sure.
And like being able to even triple spell, or if you've been ramping up to a big threat, that can be certainly relevant then.
It helps you get to Sundering Titan, which is pretty game breaking.
The fact she just cycles through a forest. Early on, like if you only have two mana, then I think it's good. I still take the Cathar. Yeah.
Me too.
I'll just go for the value card all the time.
Invigorate is a card I'm mostly familiar with from Infect.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think making your opponent gain 3 life without Infect is that relevant.
No, it's not. It's not too relevant. 3 life is like 3 life like.
I mean,
it matters, but it's not. If you get to cast this for free, if you've tapped out and you get to surprise your opponent with this, that factor is far more important than the 3 life. And +4/+4 is huge. That is a huge buff.
It is, but it's 3 mana. Mm-hmm. And I feel like you could do more for your 3 mana.
Such as a Dauntless Cathar.
Yes. I think I want my tricks to be cheaper.
Well, this can be free.
Sure, but...
Like, you can't get cheaper than 3.
Sure, if you're using it to blow out your opponent and take down a big threat, it's great.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Like, you will control a forest.
Yes.
You know, like that, like, casting this for free is an option. Always.
Okay. So where in a pack would you take an Invigorate? Because this is...
I need to be already in green. Again, I'm not first picking it. And I need to be relatively aggressive, like a deck that is looking to curve out and turn its guys sideways. Like, I'm always in the market for a cheap trick, and I want something that allows me to interact in combat. So a lot of the time, like, kind of when you start off playing Magic, kind of combat tricks are kind of deemed poor. Like, you want more removal, and certainly that's the case. But in cases where you don't get removal, you can use tricks like this as removal, engineering combat scenarios where you get to blow out your opponent. And something like Invigorate does fit that
where
bill.
You look tapped out.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they'll have to play around that.
Okay. Right.
Now, I'm probably taking this, middle of the pack. I'm already in green.
All right, what about our second uncommon, Spike Shot Goblin?
So combos really well with Invigorate.
Yes.
Are there any, I don't know, like, I know the set, but I don't know it, like, all the cards. Are there any auras that you can put on this that give it, like, +2, +3, anything like that? Because that would certainly be a combo with it.
There are. I can't think of one offhand particularly that, you know, maybe.
Yeah, like the sets too new. I don't know all the commons and commons off the top of my head, but those are the typical.
All right, Jeff behind the camera says there are no auras.
He's just
a tappy do one-y boy.
Yeah, so I'm dying out.
Maybe not take him. Let's move on to this. This is the card I'm most excited about. This is the classic Lightning Bolt.
So
this is a real master card right here.
It's hard when we're looking at on Earth and seeing the Lightning Bolt coming up ahead.
Yeah, you know it's coming. You know what you want.
Yeah, no, the Lightning Bolt is like. We'll talk about the rares in a moment, but yeah, Lightning Bolt is probably my pick. It's just generically powerful, it's one of the best removal spells ever printed, and always go to the face if necessary.
It removal? It's Bolt, turn one. Lava Spike. At some point you're dead.
So you're playing Limited, you play Mountain, turn one, Lightning Bolt.
Bolt in
your
the
opponent,
face.
Yeah, just send a message, just let them know.
What message?
What kind of... Oh.
It's not a message, you're just making them slightly more dead.
That's just every day. That's just every day, James. Yeah, okay.
No, it's great in... multiple scenarios. It's great if you're blocking and want to take down a bigger creature. You can help a smaller creature trade up. You can just take out something small. You can finish the game off if you need to. It's great at any point in the game, I think.
Yeah, no, absolutely. It's so hard to play around as well for just one mana. Like if they just leave off that sneaky one mountain, you're just like, how do I fight against that? Like, yeah, no, Bolt is always great, and it's definitely the pick for me.
And it breaks up the Horseshoe Crab. Presence of Gone combo.
Yeah, which is the dominant important. Tier 1 combo.
Yeah, I don't know how else you beat that in the format. I mean, it's not like there's Swords to Plowshares or anything else.
No,
Bolt, Murder.
Bolt is fantastic. So,
yeah, I think it's got to be the pick for me. But we do have not one, but two rares.
Mm-hmm.
Rurikthar the Unbowed and Big Bad Daddy Dragon himself, Nicol Bolas. So let's talk about Rurik first.
So he's a big guy. I generally subscribe in Limited to not taking multicolored cards, pack one, pick one, unless they're extremely powerful.
Well, he has both Vigilance and Reach, and he's a 6/6. I think he ticks the powerful boxes. He also has two heads and an axe for a hand.
He's definitely a powerful card. Like,
is that because he has an axe for a hand?
Sorry?
He's an axe for a hand. I mean, that's quite relevant.
That's where...
That gives him the reach, because he's like... snapping birds out of the sky with his axe hand.
How much of the power is in the axe? So he's a 6/6.
Probably 4.
So he's a minus off the axe. That
one power per head, and then 4 power per axe.
One power per head.
Well, like, how much is a bone splitter? A bone splitter is like +2, +0. So I guess it's 2.
So the heads are given 1 power each, but his massive torso.
That's two more, and then the axe is 2.
Okay,
clearly.
Okay. Playing it up.
I thought this would be obvious.
Well, I have an English degree, not an ogre degree.
Well, you know, an ogre degree might actually get you a job, not like an English degree.
Maybe. So he's a 6/6 for 6 vigilance reach. The other abilities, the attack each combat available.
Oh, you're doing that anyway with the.
And
six,
he's got vigil.
Unless
so
they're sitting there with the colossal dreadmaw for blocking, and even in that case, they trade.
Yeah, that's not a huge downside. And whenever they cast a non-creature spell again.
I mean, that's if he gets removed.
Yeah,
they get double bolted.
Yeah, so. Exactly. My personal opinion, I would still take the Bolt. Again, he's a multicolored card. I'm not necessarily going to end up. Red
sure.
and green. I'm not necessarily going to want to splash him if I end up one of them. Bolt though. So long as I'm in red, I'm playing this card.
Okay. What about Nicol Bolas? Because he's a not just two-colored, but three-colored card for 2 blue-blue, black-black, red-red, 2 double Grixis.
So if I wasn't taking Rurikthar, because he's multicolored,
you're not taking Nicol Bolas.
I'm not taking Nicol Bolas because he's
He also has an upkeep cost, which isn't exactly... Now, I know this is the classic Nicol Bolas, and he's a 7/7 flying, and you cause your opponent to discard cards, but I think the cost is just too high.
It's too damn high.
I think he's worth it. I mean, like, if you get those colors and he pops a blade, if you get a couple of cultivates or something, you want to play 4-color nonsense.
Thing is,
but
even if you're in these colors, right? It's difficult to splash because now you suddenly. So let's say you're blue black. It's difficult to splash 2 mountains. If this is your only red card, you have to make a decent commitment to try to fit him in. And now you have to pay. You have to pay the upkeep cost every turn. You're right. It isn't a huge deal. But there are some turns where you want to be able to, like, if you have 8 mana and you cast this, and now you have a 6 drop you want to cast, you don't get to cast that until you need to draw more lands. I'm still sticking with Bolt.
Right, let's see what chat thinks. And yeah, I think I'm taking Bolt here. It says Azdivona. I'm pronouncing that wrong, probably. So sorry.
Devin MTG says, are we drafting red? Because that was a sick burn.
Damn right, Devin. Bolt says Lars Markson. All right, I think we're probably in agreement. I think the majority of Magic players would take Bolt.
Yeah. Like, System Aspect's Slug is right. Like, Spike Shot can be sweet at times. And there are certain decks where it can just be a little machine gun shooting down. But I think in this pack, for our first pick, I'm just taking Bolt.
Yeah. And Systematic Slug makes a couple of good points here. I think you have to have a card to discard or get sacrificed for Balduvian Horde.
So does it?
That's interesting.
Can we bring it back up?
I think. So that does make it slightly worse. So that probably takes a little bit down in my estimation. Yeah. I'm still just taking Bolt.
Yeah, apologies for misreading that card.
And also, they also say that Aberration is pretty baller for the flexible fixing options, which is also true. It is one green
to then tap for three.
Have tree green. Yeah.
And it can colorously get you that forest for first.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. But I think it's hard to look away from Lightning Bolt in this pack.
Yeah, absolutely. Like as I said, when we first looked at it and looking at it on Earth, my eyes immediately go to that.
Just straight in.
Yeah. It's such an iconic art as well.
Yeah, so it just draws your eye right to it. That's probably one of my favorite Magic cards, I think.
Lightning Bolt?
Just in general.
Well, you did say that turn one, you're just going to go Lightning Bolt to your face.
Like, Is there another option? Alright, so we agree Lightning Bolt's the pick?
Yes, I agree.
Jeff, what do you think? Behind the camera there. Are you taking the Bolt?
Bolt for sure.
Bolt for sure. Alright, I think we're pretty much all in on the Bolt here.
Right here.
Alright, going right to the faces, Jeff. Okay, we are going to move on to something a little less serious for you, Alex. And I'm turning the tablet away because you can't see the
answers. That's difficult for me.
So chat can play along if you guys want to. We're going to play something that I first saw a Loading Ready Run do.
Truth or Dennis?
No. I didn't do that. That was the world's worst MTG YouTube channel, Windmill Slam.
I've heard of that,
I haven't. So Loading Ready Run did this in one of their episodes of Friday Nights, and I love the concept. It's Magic Card or Metal Band or both.
Okay, so I have it
I'll
right.
I'll name
so
a card for you.
Yeah.
You will tell me if it is a Magic Card,
okay,
a Metal Band, or is it both?
So these are, so if it's a Magic Card, it's an actual Magic Card.
It's an actual Magic Card.
From some set.
From a set,
okay.
Yes.
And it can be from any set?
Can be from any set.
Okay.
And sometimes it's both, and sometimes it's just a band's name.
Okay. So that's hard. Like, the fact that it can be both, that's hard. Like, metal is not my forte.
We'll keep your score. Chat will keep his score.
Okay.
And let's say, if you manage to get five of these, I'll be impressed. Because, Alex, what's your favorite kind of music?
Favorite kind of music? Rock, probably.
That's not a thing. That's, like, be more specific.
Like,
name a band you like. That's not an answer.
I like a lot of music.
You like a lot of music, but you can't name a single band.
The Decemberists.
Yeah, they're good.
See ya.
That is two different spectrums a little bit.
I listen to
whatever.
To yeah.
So you're saying
my Spotify playlist will go from like folk to metal to a classical piece.
You don't have like a particular taste in music. Or taste in music. You just like music as a general rule. I don't do this the rest of the time.
I have like playlists for different genres and then one playlist that just has everything.
Okay. So. All right. Well, how much do you like metal? Can you name a few metal bands for me? Like what kind of names do they have?
Not many. Iron Maiden and Metallica.
I was sure you were just going to say Iron Man.
Iron Man. He is metal.
Okay.
So yeah, Iron Man, Metalhead, System of a Down.
That's a few. That's more than like gave you credit for. So well done.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's see if you know if our first
Black
one.
Black Sabbath. Are they metal?
That's
That sounds metal. That's
so does everything on this list, mate.
Okay.
Okay. So our first one, and Jeff will get it up on screen. We got it up on screen. All right. Vampiric Feast. Magic Card, Metal Band, or both. Vampiric Feast.
Magic Card.
Correct. I'm impressed. Do you know which set it's from?
Absolutely not.
Neither do I. Don't worry.
I'm assuming there's a vampire in there.
I think it might be 7th edition.
Okay.
But
is it a sorcery?
Look, I didn't say I have all the answers. I just have a list with the name and whether it's a card.
All right. I'm giving you too much credit.
All right. Our next one. Well,
I'm on the board.
He's got one. Solid one. Well done.
One's more than I thought I was going
to
get.
Well, you got to get to that five.
Okay.
So, dead even. Cursed Earth.
Cursed Earth.
I know that sounds really like one of those black spells that would like curse a land, or one of those metal bands.
It could even be
that
it could
play
be,
like from Sweden or something, death metal.
Like it could be a land, like just like an actual land.
An actual taps
are colorless. Yeah, mm-hmm. Cursed Earth.
Cursed.
Is there a neither option? It's definitely
no,
one
it's
of the
definitely
other.
One, okay. The other or both. All right, look, let's see.
Cursed.
Let's
Earth.
See what chat. Thinks.
I'm going to go.
Let's see
with,
what chat thinks. Okay.
I'm going with metal for Cursed Earth.
Metal. What? You got it, you're on
yes.
tip. It is a band. Cursed Earth is
I'll
a band.
I'll leave now. That's my... All right, so yeah, I'm done.
I'll do the rest, show myself.
Two to two.
So James, Ashes to Ashes, then Magikarp, Metal Band, or both. I don't know, James, what do you think?
Ashes to Ashes.
No, you tell me. Ashes to Ashes. Ashes to Ashes. Magikarp, Metal Band, or is it a boat?
Is it a boat? Well, it's a line from a David Bowie song.
That's not going to help you right now.
But this is the question. This is question three.
Ashes to Ashes is question three. For those of you playing along at home, Alex is on two.
I'm going to go both.
He's gotten all
or
right.
Or boat. I'll go boat.
Boat.
Yeah,
boat. It is actually also the Titanic. It's both. You're right. You're actually right. Three out of three. Did you see this when you were flicking through my
screens? No. Literally.
Because I'm going to kill you.
No.
Okay. Our next one is Ragman. Is Ragman a Magikarp, Metal Band, or both? And don't get it mixed up with the Ragavan.
Yeah, Ragman.
Ragavan kind of sounds metal bandy too, right?
Ragavan.
We're Ragavan!
The monkey. Yeah.
We're here to crush, kill, and destroy! Sorry, I'll stop that.
It's a nice alter.
Sorry for your ears, Jeff.
It's a nice alter you could do. You change when you're on live TV.
Ragman, though.
Ragman. All right.
I'm significantly less dour. I can be more dour if you'd like.
So Ragman.
Ragman.
That's tough. I'm gonna go... Magic.
How? 4 out of 4? Either you're a genius or you cheated.
I did not cheat. I swear.
I'm pretty sure you cheated.
I swear on
because this is unprecedented. Never before
I
seen.
I swear I did not
four
see any
out
of these.
Four.
Did not see any of these.
All right. Our man behind the camera, Jeff, is threatening to throw packs at
I swear,
Alex if he cheated.
I swear on my GP trophy. I did not.
Can you swear on your Nintendo Switch? Because I kind of want one.
Yeah, I will. Yeah.
Great.
You can have it if I did.
If you cheated.
Yeah.
Well, if you get them all right, 10 out of 10, I'm going to see you cheated, so... okay, next one is The Fallen.
The Fallen.
The Fallen. Magikarp, Metal Band, or both?
I'm going to go Metal.
Not both, not
no,
Magikarp,
just Metal. Yeah, like, I know there are some cards that are, like, something of The Fallen something, but I'm going Metal.
Final answer?
Yeah.
You're doing so well. And now you've stopped doing well because it's both.
It is both.
The Fallen is both.
What's the card? Oh, you don't have those answers.
It's some zombie lad.
Do you want the card?
Okay.
Card should be up on screen for those of you watching on.
Do you want to hear the card?
Yeah, what's the card?
Yeah, read the card, Jeff.
One black, creature zombie. At the beginning of your upkeep, the Fallen deals one damage to each opponent that has been damaged this game.
That sounds terrible. No one should ever play it.
Is it legendary?
No.
The Fallen, it makes it seem. All right.
Class.
All right, well, that's proof
of the album cover or of the card. All right, no, we should leave Jeff alone
proof,
and let him get back to work.
That's proof that I wasn't cheating.
So, Jeff, line up our next card because it is Death Lace, but it might not be a card. It might be a metal band. It's or both.
Death Lace.
Death Lace.
Death Lace.
Death Lace, as in death, like, but also lace.
Lace.
Like
yeah.
a kitchen table
yeah,
or something.
Yeah, yeah.
Curtains.
Okay. Death Lace.
Death Lace. Like your curtains are coming to get you.
There's no way there's a magic card called Death Lace. Yeah, metal.
Sure.
Yeah.
Oh, you are wrong, sir. Deathlace is a card.
Who named it? Who did
I don't
the
know.
Art?
Mark Rosewater. Robo Rosewater. Who knows?
Ragman.
All right. Our next card is City of Shadows. I keep calling them saying our next card. I've said that for everything.
Our
back,
next
so that
card.
Doesn't give anything away, hopefully.
City of Shadows.
City of Shadows. Magic card, metal band, or both?
Oh, like I've been wrong the last two saying metal, but I'm going to say metal again.
4 out of 6 so far.
I don't think there's a card called City of
you
Shadows.
You are on 4 out of 7.
Yeah.
Now, that is, City of Shadows is a card.
Okay.
It's a land. It does something.
Okay.
It definitely does a thing, so.
Hey, you might be right that I'm not going to hit 5. I was on a roll, but now I'm
see
I'm
how
falling.
Chat's doing.
I'm falling off. This is hard.
Chat knows the cards. Out of the card,
well,
out of
have,
the dark.
Well, they have Google.
That's a straight... Like, so do you
no,
get your phone
nobody,
out.
Nobody knows that there's a card called City of Shadows.
Inspector 80 says, I hated opening Death Laces.
Well,
I bet you did.
I started in Gay Crash, not an experience.
Have all the cards been black, says Red Hot 19? Pretty much, yeah. I just looked up black cards. I mean, what else is going to sound like a metal band, right?
Some red cards, good.
The art is great. Art on which is this album cover? On City of Shadows, I assume. Okay, our next card, and or band, and or both, is Necrophagist.
Necrophagist.
Do you want me to use it in a sentence?
Yes.
Necrophagist was a card that the band Necrophagist played at their gig.
Okay. So Necrophagist.
Necrophagist.
Okay. Magic card.
No, sir. You're still on for you.
It's all falling apart.
It's all falling apart because I wanted your Nintendo.
It's all falling apart. I got it ready for you.
All right. Okay, so you're four out of eight.
Jeez.
So you're 4-4.
All right, that's off.
So you want to get that five. You get to get one of the last two right. You've got two more chances to get to the five.
Right.
So you might just do it. And if you can get to the five, I'll genuinely be impressed because that anyone knows these cards, that you start playing Gatecrash, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So these are all cards from before you
started. I assume most of them are going to be older.
And they're not ones that you're going to know.
Yeah, you're not saying Rurikthar. As a thing.
He'd be a great metal band. He's got two heads. He could play with
instruments at once. Yeah, he would.
Which head sings, though? And he's got the axe already.
The axe sings.
We should probably stop getting distracted. You're just trying to distract me from this important quiz.
All right. Hey, I want to win.
So, is Burning Witch a magic card, a metal band, or both?
Burning Witch.
Burning Witch.
Both.
Are you sure?
No, but yes.
You're running out of chances to get that magical number five.
Burning Witch sounds like it would be a magic card, and it's so generically awful that someone has to have used it in a metal
band. That is saying some bad things about the guys in Wizards who name cards.
No, Burning Witch. No. The name is awful for a metal band. That's why someone will use it. But the name, I'm saying both. Lock it in.
Band. All right, chat says band, easy. Band hasn't had an album in a decade. All right, it's...
Am I right?
No, it's banned.
Oh my god!
You don't know nothing, kid.
Burning Witch, how has that not existed?
Oh, but everybody knew Necrophagist was a band.
Okay, well, everybody's smarter than me.
Yeah, duh. You got an English degree.
Yeah.
Come on, man.
They have a Twitch degree, so that's strictly better.
Yeah, at least that's useful in modern society.
All right, hit me. Last one.
All
see
right.
If I can go
Our
five
very
and five.
Last card.
50%.
Magic card and metal band are both. I'm just building the tension here. All to play for, as Denis would say. But he's in Gdansk. Lads. Is Worms of the Earth. Worms of the Earth. Magic card.
See, I don't even get a 50% chance. I'm like a 33% chance for these.
That's sacrifice.
So Worms of the Earth.
I hope that reference doesn't last to absolutely everybody.
Worms of the Earth.
Worms of the Earth.
Metal band.
Yes, but it's also a magic card.
Oh,
so sorry, Alex Ball.
I got 4-0, and then you just...
You!
Like,
yeah, that's what I do with GPs, so don't worry about it.
I started with, yeah.
You get tired and confused.
That's really
run out
bad.
Of steam. Oh, well done.
Can I verify you weren't
cheating?
You
can verify I wasn't cheating here, and Twitch, everybody on Twitch chat knows what's going on because they have seen the cards come up on their screen. Thanks, Jeff.
Jeez.
Look at that. Look at how bad you are. Vampiric Feast, you got.
Hey, I know my vampire's ashes and Ragman.
And your curse, too. I thought Ragman would confuse you because you'd think it was Rag and Bone Man. That's why I put it in.
Sure, yeah.
But, all right, well, 4 out of 10 is not
I was expecting
completely
one. I was
shameful.
Expecting one, so.
So you had 4 good guesses, well done.
Yeah.
I'm surprised the order they went in, but.
There's no prize for 4-6.
The prize is that you
get
to move on to our next section where you get to talk about your modern Jund deck that you played at GP Madrid. So we're just going to talk a little bit about Jund, why you like it, why the pros like it, and what's so good about it. Why are people so excited? Because, Bloodbraid's back, but why do people get so excited about Jund?
Like, I get excited just looking at this.
That's
like
disturbing. I didn't want to know that.
Well, like, it's like if Brian looked at us, if Brian Whelan looked at us, Tron, he'd
That's,
get excited.
Again, I didn't want to know. I suppose if I look at a burn list, I get the same.
Yeah.
Yeah. I see 4 bolts here. I'm like, all right, then.
Nothing
I see 3 scavenging ooze. I'm like, get out of my show.
I showed because I had the deck in my bag with me at work, and I showed it to the guy I said next to. He was asking about Magic. He plays a little bit, and so I showed him this, and I said, "Yeah, like this is one of the best decks in the format at the moment." And he looks at it, and he's kind of looking at Tarmogoyf, and he's like, "Yeah, this is pretty good, but like, I don't think it would beat my Dragon Warriors deck."
And then you played, and he won.
No, I went back to work, but I don't think I probably wouldn't be able to beat dragons.
How do you beat Dragon Warriors?
This can't kill.
They're bigger
like,
than
5/5 flyers.
They're bigger than 3 damage, and they don't cost less than 2
yeah.
and or 4 mana for Fatal Push. Technically, there's no way to win. You have to make them sacrifice a dragon, but then they play more dragons.
So yeah, no, it was just the way he said it. Like, he doesn't play Modern, so he doesn't know any of the decks.
All right,
so funny.
Bloodbraid has made her glorious return to Modern.
Yes.
Why does this make the deck so much better?
So Jund's been an interesting spot. So I've played it for a total of maybe 3 years. So I played it for about 2 years and then stopped playing Modern for a while when Twin got banned. And I've had four Bloodbraid off in my binder waiting for the day that she would make her return. And as soon as she came back, I just immediately bought the deck again. And Bloodbraid Elf just completely gives this a resurgence. So it's never bad, Bloodbraid Elf. So it's good in almost any matchup. Even things like Burn. So I was mentioning earlier how...
What if they have a 3-4 and a Torpor Orb? You said it's never bad. What if they have a 3-4 and a Torpor Orb?
Well, give me a scenario where that's happening.
Where you're playing your opponent and they're playing Dragon Warriors and they have a 3-4 Dragon Warrior and a Torpor Orb.
And a Dragon Warrior Torpor Orb, okay.
No, just a Torpor Orb. That's fine. You brought it in from a sideboard.
Like, there are some scenarios where like a 3-2 haste isn't exactly what you want to be doing.
But it's just a generically good creature.
Yes. The hits in this deck, like as soon as Bloodbraid Elf and Jace got unbanned, people were saying, Bloodbraid Elf is fine, but Jace is the real powerhouse. But Bloodbraid just like fit into this deck so much because the list was already there for her. Like, it doesn't really matter what you're hitting. The big hits are obviously the 3-mana spells. So if you ever hit Liliana of either type or Colligan's Command, and then there are a few out of the sideboard like Kitchen Finks and Choke, if you ever hit a 3-mana spell, you did it. Like, that was, you managed to cast, spend 4 mana on 2 spells for a total of 7. It's insane. It feels broken when you do that. But even if you just hit a Thoughtseize or a Lightning Bolt or a Goyf or a Bob, anything, is you're still been able to get 2 spells and get the haste body as well. The haste is relevant a lot of the time, so this makes matchups like Tron better. Mm. Like it sounds weird, but
oh, you could beat Tron now. Do you think?
Yeah, the matchup is gone.
Chat says Torpor Orb doesn't stop Bloodbraid Elf Cascade, so go for it.
They're absolutely right.
What do I know about the 3-4? I don't know nothing.
Your Dragon Warrior 3-4 still blocks it, but that's fine. We'll hit a Liliana and make them sacrifice it. Easy.
Cascade is a cast trigger, so good on the Torpor Orb. Well, it shows what I know about Magic, I guess. So that confirms there is no situation where Bloodbraid Elf is bad at all, ever.
So Bloodbraid Elf makes the Tron
matchup. Needs to come up with a scenario where it's bad. Yeah.
Come up with like a 3-card scenario where it's poor.
What, but Torpor Orb, a 3-4, and...
Something that hits cast triggers, I guess.
Two disallows.
So, what... Actually, Teferi, the 5-mana spell.
You're getting way off track. tell me why the pros are excited about Jund. Because I see Turtonwald's talking about it, Reed Duke's talking about it. People are very excited to play Jund again.
So Jund and Abzan, by extension, these powerful mid-range decks just give you an avenue to leverage your skill. So there's a reason why at Mox just 2 weeks ago, there was 9 Jund. That's an outrageous number for a 24-person tournament. At the World Championships 2017, again, it's like 24 people. That number might be off, but there was something like 11 Abzan. Like, the pros gravitate towards these decks because you're never a dog in a matchup. There are certain tricky matchups, like Tron, you are definitely unfavored. Boggles now is actively very difficult. But against any of the control decks, the mid-range decks, the aggro decks, you can always fight and you can always win. And so it lets players like Reed Duke and Turnwald, both masters, it lets them leverage their skill. And they'll be able to use, even though it's not nothing exciting, they'll be able to sequence their game.
It's just those incremental advantages the deck gives.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. And like cards like Thoughtseize and Inquisition, when pros play those cards, they're completely different to when you're ordinary Magic player. They're able to just, as soon as they see their opponent's hand, they can craft the next 6 turns in advance of what's going to happen. And they can use that information so much more. Liliana as well, understanding what card you should be discarding, when to use it, etc. It's definitely a deck that's better in the hands of the pros. Okay. If you give Jund or Abzan to an inexperienced player, like, they're still going to do fine, but the difference there between the pro and the regular player is magnified versus maybe a combo deck or something like that.
Is this a good deck for someone then who is improving at Magic, is looking to start maybe going to GPs or looking to maybe day 2? Is this something that will teach them to play better Magic?
For sure, yeah. It has, like, Jund has a lot of decisions. You look at your opening hand and in terms of what lands you're playing, how to kind of build up to a Liliana, like what cards do you want left in your hand to discard? How to sequence, should you play Goyf on turn 2 or Bob on turn 2? What to discard with your discard spells? water removal spell to use on cards. It has every single turn as a decision or multiple decisions. So if that's the kind of game you want to play or learn how to play, absolutely, that's definitely going to make you a better magic. Like forcing you to make those decisions will make you a better magic player, and you'll be able to practice that. So it's also, I find it's a very fun deck. Like, I'm not a huge fan of Modern in general.
You didn't play Modern before Bloodbred Elf got unbanned.
No, I stopped playing when Twin got unbanned, or thereabouts, maybe a little bit after. And
did you say Twin got unbanned?
Sorry, banned.
The they unbanned? Oh my god!
I stopped playing, like, when Twin got banned, I had a Pro Tour a couple of weeks after that I played, and then I had to play I played Modern at Worlds last year, or 2 years ago. And other than that, I haven't played Modern in that stretch of about a year and a half. But as soon as Bloodbred Elf, even though I'm still not a massive fan of Modern as a format, but Jund is so much fun. It's just so fun being able to just cast. Have you ever cast a Bloodbred Elf?
I have not. I've not had the pleasure.
So fun. As it's so spiky. It's so, even so, it's just, even very Johnny, it's just so, so, so fun. I love it.
So we've got a few scenarios from chat on when Bloodbred Elf is bad. So it's bad when Storm just goes off and turns 3 and wins anyway.
Yeah, that's fair.
So are most things. It's bad when there's Meddling Mage with Bloodbred Elf named in play.
Okay, yeah.
That's fair. Eidolon of Rhetoric makes Bloodbred Elf not
that's
fresh.
Which one's Rhetoric? Can't cast more than one spell?
I believe that is, yeah. So yeah, that's fair. You use your Cascade trigger.
Teferi as well is you can't any... you can't cast things at instant speed, you have to cast them at sorcery speed, so you're not actually able to cast that card. So Teferi has flash, doesn't it? So
yes,
you can flash it in response. So.
Okay, so if you were playing Modern tomorrow, do you think Jund is the deck to play? Is that the deck everyone should pick up and go play at FNM or go play at a GP?
So not the questions
just
are for me for
if,
in general.
If you want a fun deck that you think you're going to enjoy playing and maybe learn to play some better magic, or do you think there's something better than this right now that is like, is this better than Grixis Shadow, for example?
Yeah, like, Jund definitely isn't the best deck. Necessarily, okay. Like, I'm not sure what the best deck is. Boggles has gotten popular, and Boggles, like, with 4 main deck, Leyline of Sanctity, is a very rough day for Jund. It's not necessarily going to be fun for everybody. It ultimately, it is quite a... It does gravitate towards spikes, for sure. So it's definitely not going to be fun for everyone to play. There are people who just want to play a combo deck. They want to play Storm. They want to play Living End or whatever it might be. But I think if you want to practice sequencing in Magic, if you want to cast a lot of 2-for-1s, and if you want to attack with... I think Goyf is well-positioned as well. So if you want to attack with a massive Goyf, you'd be surprised how quickly Goyf can get out of hand. You can make it into a 5-6 yourself, but people are just, you can discard artifacts. There's things like Eidolon. It oddly gets very big in the burn matchup because of Eidolon of Revels. I would say
it's not Eidolon of Revel, not just any Revel, it's the Great Revel.
The Great Revel, sorry, you're right. Yeah, the RRC is having a mad time.
Yeah, it's the great, they're having the great time. Okay, so...
I think the biggest kind of obstacle to Jund is the price tag. It is one of the
not Tron.
It's one of the not like the matchup against Tron is fine. Like, okay, it's I think the matchup, it's quite interesting. The matchup against Tron went from maybe 80%, 20% down to maybe now after board 60-40 maybe.
It's okay.
With Fulminators. I think Bloodbred Elf is huge in that.
Cascade into a blood or a Fulminator is pretty good.
Well, that's awesome. But even like the fact that you get to now have, you can cast Bloodbred Elf, have a hasty threat against Karn. Mm-hmm. If you hit another creature, now Karn is worse because the other creature can kill it. And the way you beat Tron is by, ultimately, the way they beat Tron is to prevent them from hitting a threat or only letting them hit like one big threat using discard spells in the early game to try to disrupt them. But then you need to kill them fast, because if you just give them unlimited turns, they will eventually draw their Karns, their Ugins, their Ulamogs, and you will lose to that. So something like Bloodbred just gives you that pressure to finish them off.
So you're saying the big barrier here is the price tag of Jund?
Yes.
There are some pricey cards. You've got your Lilies, and you've got your Goyfs, and you've got your full suite of Fetches and Shocks, I suppose. Is there a way to play it on a budget? I've seen a lot of the red-green Ponza decks with Bloodbred. That's another interesting way to play Bloodbred without paying. If you're not quite there with Jund, you can still have your Bloodbred fun and stone rain the crap out of people.
I'd say the best Bloodbred deck is probably the red-green Eldrazi deck. Okay. I won a GP a few weeks ago, and that's not crazy expensive. Like, you're still putting a couple of hundred into it, but it's just running a lot of the cheap Eldrazi from Oath of the Gatewatch. It has, like, some fetch lands. It has Cavern of Souls. That's one of the expensive pieces. But that's, in comparison, Jund's about 1,200 or so.
But you can, whereas, you can have Bloodbraid fun.
You can have Bloodbraid fun
without
yeah.
playing.
You don't need. You don't need like lilies and goyves.
Because we don't want to exclude people here.
Yeah.
From your beloved Bloodbraid that you that you.
But like Bloodbraid's fun no matter what you're cascading in. I could cascade into nothing. I could just have six. I could have 56 lands and 4 Bloodbraids, and I'll have fun just flipping over those.
Just flip
those cards. I like the physicality of it. It's great fun.
All right, I think you've gone into way too much detail on the Bloodbraid Atlas. The physicality.
All right. Yeah.
So we've got time for just one more section in the show today. Our fact or fiction, which is. Chaos drafts are the most fun way to play Magic. Fact or fiction, Alex?
So, they are the
most... They are the most fun. Is that a fact or a fiction?
No, that's straight up. That's straight up fiction.
Fiction?
Yeah, that's straight up fiction. Why? So,
why?
Chaos drafts are fun once. You do it
They're different every time.
You do it for the first time. Yeah, but the concept is the same. So, like, Chaos draft isn't a format. It's so... Like, it's literally chaos. So, I kind of view a Chaos draft... as taking out your wallet, taking out €25, grabbing a lighter, and setting that €25 on fire.
Rambitious Lemur says that he told you it was the best format.
No, okay.
Because I think it is fact.
Like, he said it'll help me at the Chaos PT, okay.
All right, well, so you think it's equivalent to burning money?
Yes, yeah.
Why?
Like it is,
why
like,
do you, what do you not get out of it you get out of the rest of Magic?
It is fun when you do it with your friends, because then you get to watch their misery.
I've been
involved in
the
chaos draft themselves.
Well, for me, it's fact. I love chaos draft.
Why though?
Because you go into a situation where you meet, it's like especially GP, you meet 7 people, maybe you haven't met before, maybe you've got a couple of friends, and you do something very silly, very fun. Like you open a Kamigawa pack, and you're just passing around, and everyone's just like, what is this nonsense?
What is this nonsense?
And everyone's
exactly.
But everyone's in the same boat. You're all equally confused, horrified, and
miserable.
And laughing your heads off. You're having a great time. And like you're not burning money. The best EV is fun. You're playing a game. That is the best thing.
Best EV is pro points and cash.
Absolutely not. It is that is fiction. The best thing you can do with Magic is enjoy playing Magic.
Yeah,
you enjoy Bloodbraid Elf. You just enjoy it differently.
Yeah, I won't deny, like, ultimately I wouldn't play Magic if it wasn't fun. But if you give me the option of drafting, do a Chaos draft or just an ordinary standard set, like Rivals or something, I'll play the standard set. Because at least then it's still fun, I still get to meet new people, still get to play Magic, it's cheaper, and it's an actual format. It's a format you can prepare for, it's a format you can learn from.
But like, you're assuming that preparing for a format is...
Well, I think about it a different way. Like when I play like a regular Rivals draft, even if it's just a random side event, I'm still trying to improve my game and get better at Magic. And Chaos draft, like, okay, you can practice sequencing and things like that, but like, Kev at the GP was just like, oh, the secret to Chaos draft is just take the black cards because that's removal. And it's like, well, thanks for confirming the black does
that.
Not,
is it not the purest form of Magic then? Because you were just taking the best cards in a vacuum and trying to make a deck out of garbage. And isn't that the most skill testing thing for a spike like you?
No, not at all.
Because how is it not the most skill testing thing to have absolute crap and see if you can win with it?
Like it has some qualities. Like that, like I'll give you like a 20% for that
spike thing.
Yeah, yeah. no, like I'm not going to be completely miserable playing it. Like we did one at Madrid. We got eight Irish people to play it. They waited for us, and everyone kind of like no one in that 8 wanted to play, but they played because they wanted the other 7 to be miserable.
A bunch of miserable spikes having a bad time. We had a fun thing. Oh no!
But we had fun.
Maybe
out of our misery.
Well, that's great. It doesn't, as long as you had a good time playing Magic, isn't that?
Sure.
Isn't that the real meaning of Christmas?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay, let's see what chat says. So Red Hot 19 says it's probably in their top 5, but nothing is more fun than Vintage Cube. Vintage Cube is absolutely great, so you're not wrong there. Tybook says if they want something wacky and fun that is random with a little skill, they'll play craps. I like all the pre-work, so I think that's somebody who agrees with you. But your pal Kev, Ambitious Lemur,
Oh, that is what he said.
He's disagreeing with you in chat.
He literally said...
You're getting called, eh?
He literally said, pick black and red cards because they have removal. And he's not wrong.
Well,
white has
removal too.
He's not wrong. Like, if you're going to win at a Chaos Draft, you just want a normal deck that has removal.
Well, I don't think we're ever going to agree on the Chaos Draft thing, but what is fun in Magic for you? Because I think it's very different from the kind of fun I have is very much based on, like, I like meeting people, playing some silly things, yeah. And, like, having games at EDH and stuff. What do you like? Like, what do you enjoy?
Like, I like when my opponent extends their hand when I've beaten them. That's fun.
All right, that's been our show for tonight. Alex Ball is an inhuman monster. Thanks for watching. I've been James, replacing Dennis. We'll be back on Monday at 6:30 UTC and should be back for the foreseeable future. You don't have to see my ugly mug anymore. Thanks very much for watching.
Thanks,
and guys. We'll see you again soon.
Have a good night.